We would like to thank Skillshare for sponsoring today's video. Skillshare is an online learning community with more than 30,000 classes in design, business, and more. Skillshare is giving away a free 2-month unlimited access trial to our subscribers who click on the link in the description, and after the trial, it's only around $10 a month. In 1983, audiences the world over were introduced to Ian McDiarmid's Emperor Palpatine, the grand big bad of the Star Wars saga. Across both the original and prequel trilogies, Palpatine wreaked havoc on the Star Wars universe, the progenitor of two galactic conflicts and the Sith Lord who managed to turn the Chosen One into his own personal puppet. And he loved every single goddamn second of it right to the end. Now the daddy of Star Wars villainy is returning. Finally, a holy lord at Christmas I can worship. And if there's one thing Star Wars fans can all agree on, it's that everyone f***ing loves them some Palpy. Palpatine is universally loved. But why? Seriously. Isn't it odd given how utterly divisive the Star Wars prequels are? How just about every moment and minute detail across all three films has its fans either screaming with joy or decrying blasphemy? How amongst all of those starkly different reactions, does Palpatine come out on top as a beacon that unifies Star Wars fans? What is it about McDiarmid's performance that galvanizes the fan base? What is it about his revelry for all things evil that never fails to entertain? And why is it McDiarmid's turn as the Emperor exemplary of why the prequels work and why they don't? Looking at Ian McDiarmid's performance across not only The Phantom Menace, Attack of the Clones and Revenge of the Sith, but his appearances in the original trilogy as well, we're going to take a deep dive into the art of a truly great camp performance and the artistic merits behind it. After a cameo in Empire Strikes Back, performed in the original cut by Marjorie Eaton and voiced by Clive Revel respectively, Emperor Palpatine was finally introduced as a principal character in Return of the Jedi. With only a tiny appearance to go off on, McDiarmid had free rein to bring whatever he wanted to the role and make it his own.
I didn't really get any information about him except he was extremely old and he ran the universe. And I didn't have the full script. I think very few people had the full script in those days.
With so little to work from, it could have gone in an entirely different direction, but McDiarmid felt there was more than enough meat to the material to craft something great.
But again, it didn't really matter. As I say, the scenes were strong. The situation couldn't have been stronger.
Bolstered by an excellent working relationship with Mark Hamill, whom McDiarmid noted was a joy to work with, the thespian managed to concoct his first stab at playing the Phantom Menace. It's a performance that lays the groundwork for much of Palpatine's essence.
Break me down with all of your hatred, and your journey towards the dark side will be complete. Let the hate flow through you.
Before this, we only saw the dark side through pain and regret in Vader, but Palpatine finally introduced audiences to a Sith Lord who relished in causing torment and living deliciously.
You want this. The hate is swelling in you now.
Encountering Luke Skywalker for the first time, the Dark Lord is keen to turn him to the ways of the Sith and replace Vader as his new apprentice. Spending most of his time sitting down, McDiarmid relied on his facial expressions to convey Palpatine's nasty revelry.
Oh, I'm afraid the deflector shield will be quite operational when your friends arrive.
He sounds weary, yet his intonations on certain choice words convey the sinister grandeur the character beckons. For the most part, the performance is big, but in Return of the Jedi, there is also a quiet menace to him.
Now, young Skywalker, you will die.
It always chills me to the core hearing him deliver that, like ending his life is nothing on his conscience. And as Vader is given his last chance to choose between the light and the darkness, Palpatine's insidious little twitch here is full tilt evil. It implies an intense satisfaction inflicting such pain, but also an anger, unable to turn Luke and failing to accomplish his goal. It's incredible that McDiarmid is able to give such a cutting performance in such heavy makeup. But it sounds like this was actually what provided him with much of the impetus for his creative decisions.
And the character was almost given to me by that face. I looked at the face and the voice followed.
But we very nearly didn't get this voice at all. George Lucas reportedly informed Richard Marquand to inform McDiarmid that he wanted him to craft his voice on Clive Revel's original rendition, but the actor disagreed, feeling that Palpatine's voice should be deeper and closer to what he had already come up with.
And Richard said, yes, well, that's good. You've been doing that voice, I see, throughout. And George actually is quite taken with it, so just go on doing it.
And thank God. Could you imagine hearing anything else?
This will not be
to 1999, and McDiarmid reprised the role for Star Wars Episode I, The Phantom Menace, followed swiftly by follow-up appearances in Episode II, Attack of the Clones, and Episode III, Revenge of the Sith. These films depict a much younger Palpatine, one who is already deeply proficient in the ways of the dark side, but is yet to reveal his true nature. Instead, Darth Sidious, aka Emperor Palpatine, is merely Senator Palpatine.
We will watch your career with great interest.
McDiarmid not only gets a stab at the character without prosthetic makeup, but he's essentially playing a dual role. The squeaky clean politician Palpatine exudes warmth and compassion, but with a stern, commanding veneer.
You could call for a vote of no confidence in Chancellor Valorum.
It's not until the third movie that we get to see him return to the outed Palpatine, but you'll notice his performance, whilst operating on the same basic principles, is distinctly different from his turn in Jedi. In these prequels, McDiarmid finds something wonderful with the character and channels that all-important magic of campy acting. Susan Sontag, in her seminal essay Notes on Camp, described the idea of camp as its love of the unnatural, of artifice and exaggeration. This key descriptor of exaggeration is often why we can attribute deliberately cheesy or over-the-top performances to campiness. It is a sensibility that, among other things, converts the serious into the frivolous. Campy acting can take darker material with a seemingly serious tone, remove any apparent cynicism, and inject it with humour. Campy performances can give us some of the most memorable gold in an otherwise forgettable scene. They can elevate entire movies if it's the perfect storm of a camp performance in a movie that's equally OTT. But it's a fine, fine line. Often a camp performance can end up being in a movie that doesn't have the right tone for it. This is always especially eye-rolling when the other performers in the movie aren't taking the material and exaggerating it themselves.
Oh, what's the matter? Have you given up so soon?
There's no point. Where would I go?
As Sontag says, of course not all seriousness that fails can be redeemed as camp. Only that which has the proper mixture of the exaggerated, the fantastic, the passionate, and the naive. In terms of art and popular culture, Sontag actually mentions a list of pop culture items which are part of the canon of camp, which include the old Flash Gordon comics. These old comics are of course gloriously campy, with bold, bright colours and pulp heroes to boot. They also served as a key inspiration in the creation of the very first Star Wars movie for George Lucas. So it seems apt that the art of camp and camp acting is channeled through McDiarmid's mesmerising performance. The fun he injects into the role plays credence to the very birth of Star Wars itself. This franchise toys with darkness, loss, and death, as much as it does comedy, hope, and campiness. The Star Wars prequels are way goofier than the original trilogy.
Oh, excuse me.
Check it out, Corporal. We'll cover you.
Roger, roger.
But most of the characters don't fit into that mold.
As a member of the Senate, maybe I can find a diplomatic solution to this mess.
Don't worry. I've given up trying to argue with you.
It's not necessarily the fault of the actors, but even characters that I like fall prone to a monotone delivery of dialogue. But in fairness, sometimes the dialogue makes it exceptionally hard to pull off.
I don't like sand. It's coarse and rough and irritating, and it gets everywhere.
I think Ian McDiarmid has always understood the core of what makes Palpatine great. Star Wars is a story filled with hope and revolution, but it's safe to say its characters suffer time and time again. Not Palpy. Oh no, Palpy is loving life 24/7, so McDiarmid naturally plays into this. He takes the core tenets of his performance from Return of the Jedi, and he makes it louder, more exaggerated, and with grander body language. He's not afraid to have fun with it. Two moments that always stand out to me are these. The yelp he gives is so cowardly lion and just undignified. And then the expression he gives here as he realizes Yoda is about to mess him up is the moment where he knew he screwed up. Sontag states that all camp things will contain a large element of artifice, and this is of course true of the Emperor. Throughout the saga, the Emperor is the trickster, the guy behind the guy, the puppet master pulling all of the strings. You're never quite sure of his true intentions and allegiances. The only thing true to Sheev Palpatine is that he serves himself. George Lucas describes the character as the devil himself, that in and of itself an artifice. The devil is an idea, an embodiment of evil values rather than a person that we can truly associate with human thoughts and feelings. It makes so much sense that McDiarmid carries the role with such larger-than-life weight. But more so than that, Ian McDiarmid's performance is so good that it explains the biggest problem with the prequels. You see, the prequels aren't necessarily bad movies, on paper. As a prequel story to the original trilogy, in concept, I feel like these movies justify their right to exist, which is often the biggest hurdle any prequel has to face before it even passes go. The mission objective is to tell the rise and fall of Anakin Skywalker, a story that dovetails perfectly with episodes 4, 5, and 6, which focuses on his children's journeys and his eventual redemption. As six films telling one concise narrative from beginning to end, these movies have a legitimate right to exist over, say, I don't know, a prequel movie that attempts to flesh out a single sentence in a title crawl and explain away a plot hole that didn't need explaining. I don't need to know any more than that. It's perfectly okay to assume that a planet-sized space station would produce a lot of energy and therefore need exhaust ports leading to the main reactor. It's fine, seriously, it's fine, okay? Okay, so is the problem the writing? Well, I would say no. Wait. Structurally, I would say no. Let me explain. Imagine you've never seen the prequels. You never knew they existed. So someone explained the plot of each movie to you. The story of Anakin Skywalker, a slave discovered by two Jedi Masters, is drafted into the Order because of his unusually high aptitude for the Force. In spite of his age, Qui-Gon Jinn pushes for the boy to be trained, and in spite of being hesitant, his apprentice agrees to do so on his master's deathbed. In spite of the love Obi-Wan Kenobi has for Anakin, the pair have a tense relationship. And in many ways, Obi-Wan comes to represent both Anakin's frustrations with the Jedi Order, but also the reason why he chooses to stay. His emotional problems characterized by the crushing separation anxiety of his mother, a thread that pays off when Anakin slaughters her captors in cold blood, and his need to do well, to impress, to be the Jedi his Chosen One title would suggest, all feed into his downfall. And when his wife is in danger of dying in childbirth, the Jedi continue to deal under the table and show him no respect. In turn, it makes perfect sense that he would confide in Palpatine, and when that man claims to have the power to save the ones he loves, Anakin finally snaps and turns his back on the Jedi. Palpatine's master plan, orchestrating the Clone Wars and playing both sides, comes to a marvelous crescendo as he seizes power and uses his newly christened apprentice Darth Vader to wipe out all but two Jedi, including Obi-Wan himself, who is forced to fight his beloved apprentice to the death. Except he doesn't go through with it. Winning their duel, Obi-Wan should kill Anakin right then and there, but he takes the coward's way out. And because of Obi-Wan's cowardice and Palpatine's exploitative ways, Anakin survives, but at a terrible price. From a boy who had an incredible life of heroism and light ahead of him, he ends up destroying everything he cares about, losing his children to obscurity and becoming imprisoned by his own body in a metal cage. The very villain he was born to destroy instead becomes the manipulator who bends Anakin to his will. It's tragic, epic, and this is key, operatic. It's like a Shakespearean tragedy set in space. On paper.
This is getting out of hand. Now there are two of them.
My trick's gonna work on me. Only money.
You were right about one thing, Master. The negotiations were short.
They're like animals, and I slaughtered them like animals.
The dialogue consistently holds it back. Time and time again, a scene that could work on paper is ruined by cack-handed lines.
Anakin, Chancellor Palpatine is evil! From my point of view, the Jedi are evil!
But Ian McDiarmid understood that his clunky, operatic dialogue needed a certain style of acting to pull it all off. Is there a single moment of Ian McDiarmid that isn't great in the prequels? Every moment in which he relishes his evil deeds is a hoot. Every scene he plays both sides with a cheeky glance or cracks a wicked smile is hugely entertaining. Yes, it's camp. Yes, it's OTT as hell. But it works. It fits right in with the silliness. But his performance also knows when to go smaller, when to hit home, and proves to us that the prequels are a hefty rewrite from being something closer to the greatness of the original trilogy. This is why the Opera House scene is one of the best in the entire prequel trilogy. Dare I say, the saga. Ian McDiarmid here bears the weight of most of the dialogue, and Christensen is largely reacting.
Ironic. He can save others from death, but not himself.
Is it possible to learn this power?
Not from a Jedi.
McDiarmid commands the scene. Look at his face, he's so deliciously evil. You get the sense that he's been waiting for this specific moment for a very long time. It's the moment where all the trust he's built up with Anakin across so many years is about to pay off. Christensen mainly asks questions and merely listens as McDiarmid guides the scene. Without unbearable lines to deal with, his performance is markedly better. Generally, when people in the prequels who aren't Palpatine shut up, it tends to kick it up a notch.
He said, "You've turned to the dark side."
And if we need further proof of this, look no further than...
Hello there.
Yes. Ewan McGregor's Obi-Wan Kenobi, the other major player in the Star Wars prequels to receive almost unanimous praise for his work. Whilst not weaponizing the same brand of scenery-chewing mischief, McGregor's Obi-Wan is markedly more over the top than his co-stars. To a lesser extent, I'd throw Christopher Lee's Count Dooku in there as well.
Surely you can do better.
It's no surprise that he was able to take his Hammer horror roots and channel it into the goofy opera that is the prequels. And when we get Palpatine, Obi-Wan and Dooku in one scene, the fun is firing on all cylinders.
Kill him.
Twice the pride, double the fall.
Chancellor Palpatine. Sith Lords are our speciality.
Is it a coincidence that so many lines in this single scene get quoted and turned into memes? Palpatine and Obi-Wan are the only characters in the Star Wars prequels who are unashamedly loving life. In films so bombastic and at times silly in their tones, characters like these, with performances that are big and over the top, have the chops to match the movie. They're the inverse of a character like Jar Jar Binks, designed to evoke fun but instead missing the mark so badly it derails the flow of the entire film and every time he appears. No disrespect to Ahmed Best, he's a champ. I mean, is it really so hard to believe it's the dialogue, not the story and the purpose of the scenes themselves, that are the problem, when such high-caliber actors like Natalie Portman and Samuel L. Jackson can't make some of this stuff work?
Hold me, like you did by the lake on Naboo.
In Revenge of the Sith, we finally got to see Palpatine wield a lightsaber, much to McDermid's surprise.
When, you know, when they said there'd be a bit of fighting, I thought, oh great, you know, I'll do a lot of that and people will collapse.
And even though the choreography isn't up there with the best lightsaber fights, I still can't help but be massively entertained by this scene. And that is 100% down to McDermid's scenery chewing.
The Senate will decide your fate.
I am the Senate.
Every smirk and guttural yelling he gives out, you get the feeling that this fight is immensely satisfying for Palpatine. He's waited years to stick it to the Jedi, patiently having to put up with all of their bullshit, and now he gets to finally reveal his true self. He doesn't have to hide behind a facade, he can show off his true immeasurable power, which is unlucky for some. McDermid's performance saves so much of the trilogy, even in moments that miss the mark spectacularly. Vader's transformation is a fantastic scene. Intercut with the birth of his children as his wife hangs at death's door, we see the sick and twisted surgery that he is subjected to as he writhes around in pain. Anakin's eyes, as he sees the mask of Vader descend upon him, squeezes out any last ounces of empathy we might have for him. He looks scared, confused, and truly alone. Again, no dialogue, and this bit is great, right? And then... It's spoiled somewhat by Vader yelling no. It would be easy to complain about the line and forget everything else that's going on here. So instead, whenever I think about this scene, I think of the quiet brilliance behind the smirk Palpatine gives. He did it. He successfully manipulated the Chosen One into his personal flying monkey and managed to convince him that Padme's death is entirely on him. He tricked him, and he didn't get any kind of comeuppance. And you get all of that evil crystallized in just that one little smirk. It saves that scene. By the final turn of Revenge of the Sith, Palpatine dons the familiar black robes from the original film and takes his place as the Emperor we knew from 1983. After a movie of delightful overacting, McDermid doesn't say a word. Spectacular. I never thought Palpatine would return in the new trilogy beyond making a ghostly cameo, but here we are. As much as I loved him to pieces, and he's undeniably the big bad of the saga, it seems a little strange to me that he's going to come out of the woodwork to challenge the new heroes. On the flip side, there's enough connective tissue potentially there in episodes 7 and 8 to make it work. For example...
And I will finish what you started.
Why would Anakin communicate to Kylo through the mask? We know he can manifest himself as a Force ghost, and more to the point, why would he ever leave Kylo down a path of hatred? It's always made sense to me that the spirit behind this must be Palpatine. Or at one time, I thought it could have been Palpatine or Snoke. Obviously, that's a moot point now. Kylo Ren took his place as the leader of the First Order in the last movie. He made his choice to double down on the power of the dark side. I wouldn't want him to be redeemed in some sense because it would feel like a retread of what happened to Anakin. And the whole point of that character and why he's so interesting is because he does the one thing his idol was never able to do. Topple his dark master. He did what Anakin tried to do with Palpatine and succeeded. He spends his life trying to grow beyond Vader's accomplishments, and by becoming the leader rather than the lackey, he does just that. So would redemption feel like a step back? Well, I could get behind the idea that Kylo could be turned by having the ground beneath his feet torn away, namely if he spent his entire existence obsessed with the myth of his grandfather and even got the chance to communicate in some form with his spirit, how the hell would he feel if he found out that wasn't the truth? What would he do with himself if he found out that Palpatine was the one behind the mask, that his grandfather stayed in the light beyond his demise, and would never have encouraged him to take the same path? I can only imagine this would give incredible impetus to rethink every single choice he's ever made. So maybe, just maybe, this could all work. Sometimes with Star Wars, you've got to be a little like Lando. Everyone at the Space Battle of Endor thinks his best friend Han Solo has failed, but he stays optimistic.
I told you they'd do it!
Be like Lando. The trailers for The Rise of Skywalker indeed imply that Ian McDiarmid has toned down his performance from his last outing as the late great Sith Lord. I doubt we'll get a sheave of scenery chewing or spectacularly over the top camp, but this reflects the more understated tone of the sequel trilogy, which is definitely closer tonally to episodes 4, 5 and 6. It also just makes sense in terms of the continuity. Palpatine is far older between Revenge and Return, obviously, and then there's 30 years on top of that where his essence has been in slumber.
Long have I waited.
The entire VO in the latest trailer keeps it to a stirring, low energy. Just like in the throne room scene, we're likely hearing a Palpatine whose master plan has yet to come to fruition. So maybe we'll get a little bit more full tilt Palpy at the climax of the story, who knows? Sontag wrote that what was banal can, with the passage of time, become fantastic. Many people who listened with delight to the style of Rudy Vallée, revived by the English pop group The Temperance Seven, would have been driven up the wall by Rudy in his heyday. And indeed, many hated the prequels when they were released. But years later, countless memes of countless lines over and over again are spread across the internet. People discuss these movies, break down these movies, it's incredible. And when you see the prequels reconstituted in such a way with such passion by people who have such an affection for material, has the passage of time not turned them into something fantastic? Sontag was keen to make sure that we all knew. Many examples of camp are things which, from a serious point of view, are either bad art or kitsch. Not all though. Not only is camp not necessarily bad art, but some art which can be approached as camp merits the most serious admiration and study. Well, in that case, I shouldn't say it, but
do it.
I shouldn't.
Do it.
I have a genuine love for the prequels, okay? They fired up my imagination as a child, and even though I could only call the final installment a good movie, they each hold a place in my heart for Star Wars as a whole, and I wouldn't like them half as much without Ian McDiarmid.
I really feel I know Palpsy quite well. We've been intimates for the best part of 30 years.
Even though many actors have admirably taken on the role of Palpatine in animation, there's only one true Palpatine, and that's Ian McDiarmid. And even though I'm still uncertain as to whether or not Palpatine's return will work in Episode 9, the one thing I can be sure of is that every moment he's on screen will be an utter joy. Thank you again to Skillshare for making today's video possible. Skillshare has more than 30,000 classes to choose from, and we've loved exploring the rich range of courses they have to offer. Last time we looked at creative video storytelling and editing, but today I wanted to highlight digital poster design, combining images and type for powerful visuals by Temi Coker. Whilst Coker's tutorial is focused on poster design, the skills here are easily transferable to YouTube and provide a near essential crash course in advanced thumbnail design. Coker doesn't just detail cool features like reaction diffusion, but also gives you a load of time-saving tips like using the record feature to easily replicate complex actions. If you're looking at enhancing your design skills and creating incredible images to drive traffic to your website or channel, then this is the course for you. If this sounds up your street, then premium membership gives you unlimited access so you can join the classes and communities that are right for you. Use our link in the description for 2 free months of unlimited access to fuel your curiosity, creativity, or career. The Star Wars tracks in this video were very kindly provided by Samuel Kim Music. You can check out some of his awesome tracks over at his channel, the details of which are in the description below. Thank you for watching another Full Fat video. If you'd like to see more from Full Fat videos, why not follow us on Instagram and Twitter? Please consider becoming a patron on Patreon. We've got some cool exclusive content on there. Thank you to our $100 patrons, Dr. Chike and Jax Merrick. Chris and I really, really appreciate it. Until next time, stay milky.